In speaking about the development of moral conceptions in Rousseau's discourse, what do we have in mind? What are we talking about when it comes to moral conceptions? These are our basic sort of, not just imaginations or concepts of good and bad, right and wrong, even things like honorable and dishonorable, noble and base, but also our feelings about that. For Rousseau, thoughts and feelings, or as he talks about it, thoughts and passions or emotions, they come together and they don't function in necessarily a harmony, but they fit in with each other. And when we're thinking about moral conceptions, another way that we should frame this to ourselves is in terms of the sorts of things that put a demand upon us that then we either have to assent to, agree with, or go against. And there can be jarring, there can be inconsistent moral conceptions at work for a given person. For instance, one can be motivated by self-interest and at the same time feel the effects of natural compassion overriding the self-interest. And then one, because we have free will, could say, I'm not going to listen to either one of these. I'm going to do something totally stupid and destructive that will neither satisfy self-interest nor natural compassion. That's a possibility for human beings. But then these moral conceptions are the very broad fabric that comprise our moral life. So the oughts, the shoulds that we feel. Rousseau, by the way, is not somebody who, although he's going to say that some of our morality is artificial or you know, derived from things that don't really turn out to be what they purport to be, he's not going to be one of these people who says, oh, don't say should or don't say ought, because that actually has a very important role in distinctively human existence. So what we're interested in here is charting out a development or a progression. It's not a progress in the sense of everything getting better and better and better, the way that a lot of people think of progress. As a matter of fact, Rousseau, at different points in this discourse, will say, well, human beings were best off here, or perhaps they're supposed to be at this point. It's very clear that he thinks that the state of civilization that we currently live in is not the best state for us, but it's the one that we're stuck in. And since all of these conceptions remain operative in the final state that we're in, this state of civilization, it's important for us to be able to chart out what they are, to understand each one in turn, to see how they arose and then how they were eventually supplanted. So we're going to begin by looking at his discussions of the state of nature and self-interest and natural compassion or sympathy. And then we're going to look at the development of morality. And then we're going to talk about the next, you know, progression into property, wealth, the struggle between rich and poor, struggle between rich and rich, actually, for that matter, and this critical moment of the institution of law. This doesn't take us all the way through to the very end of the discourse, because there's still more to discuss after this. But this is a really important framework to get down as you're trying to make sense of what's going on. Here we can talk about Rousseau as actually providing us with something like three different ethics, one of which he is endorsing unqualifiedly, pretty much. The other which he is saying, well, it's not bad. It's not the best for human beings, but it's still not bad. And one of which he is in the process of trying to criticize and reject. So let's look at the state of nature first. Now you notice that Rousseau spends quite a bit of time criticizing what he takes as mistaken views of the state of nature. And one of those has to do with moral conceptions. You'll remember as well that one of the things that Rousseau is criticizing is people in this condition, in the state of civilized society, projecting civilized human beings and civilized human sensibilities back onto these primitive human beings and saying, they must be like that. They're just like us, just lacking in the sort of technology and lifestyle that we enjoy. Rousseau says that's not really the case. And he's criticizing Hobbes in particular here, but there's a lot of other moral theorists and political theorists that would fall under this as well. So I'm going to read this passage to you. He says, "It appears at first view that men in a state of nature having no moral relations or determinate obligations one with another could not be either good or bad, virtuous or vicious, unless we take these terms in a physical sense, and we call in an individual those quality vices which may be injurious to his preservation," so we have self-interest already active there, "and those virtues which contribute to it. In which case, he would have to be accounted most virtuous, who put the least check on the pure impulses of nature." So if we're only thinking in physical terms about the human animal, then we can use things like good and bad, virtuous and vicious, and we're just talking about functioning of the body. So good things would be things that are conducive to health, and bad things would be things that are detrimental to health. A good person would be somebody who's in good condition, and if you get sick, now you're a bad person. But that doesn't really capture the moral sense of the term good and bad. And what we're interested in here is whether there is this sort of notion of good or bad in the state of nature. So he says, "We have to suspend the judgment we might be led to form on this sort of state until we've looked at it and seen whether virtues or vices preponderate among civilized people, and whether their virtues do them more good than their vices do harm. If we want to project backwards onto the state of nature and say, you know, we have ideas that are loftier, that are higher than them. You know, we have a sense of fairness. But those near monkeys back in the ancestral age, they didn't really have a conception of fairness. So they're not good people. They're actually bad people. If we were going backward into this primitive past, we'd have to be on our guard against them. Or, you know, we could think of other virtues that we tend to esteem. Or other conceptions of goodness. Now, does that mean that they have no conception of goodness at all? They're operating according to some conceptions, as we'll see. So he says, "Let's not conclude with Hobbes that because man has no idea of goodness, he must be naturally wicked. That he's vicious because he does not know virtue. That he always refuses," here's the key point, "to do his fellow creatures services which he does not think they have a right to demand, or by virtue of the right he truly claims to everything he needs, he foolishly imagines himself the sole proprietor of the whole universe." Hobbes had said that in the original state of nature, human beings had a perfect right to everything, and there were no, you know, lasting conceptions of good or evil, and human beings would just do whatever they happened to do. What they happened to do, in Hobbes' account, was try to get as much as possible for themselves and to dominate everybody else around them. Rousseau says that's not actually going to be the case. That's not something that's going to happen here. That'll happen here, or even more so here. But that's not what's happening in the state of nature. They may not have articulate conceptions of right and wrong, complex codes of morality, a ability to say precisely what goodness consists in, but that doesn't mean that their behavior then automatically becomes bad. Why not? Well, here we have to think about what nature has endowed us with, according to Rousseau. So let's start with self-interest. When we talk about self-interest, or another word that he uses, egoism, what we mean there is not the sort of self-interest that just, you know, subordinates everything to itself and would consume the entire universe, or which would, you know, not even, you know, wiggle a finger if that would save the entire human race. What we mean is just self-preservation. As he said, animals are machines that are constructed in such a way as to take in sense impressions, to see what conduces to their self-preservation, to their health, to their flourishing, and to see what you know is detrimental to it, and to avoid those things and pursue those things. So we're like that as well. We have a natural instinct to preserve ourselves. You put your hand on a hot plate, you're going to take it off. If you don't, then there's something wrong with your body because you're not sensing the pain that you ought to sense. And you're probably going to, you know, if you were in a state of nature, you wouldn't last if that was the case. If you lacked normal nervous impulses to you know, go away from pain, or, you know, pull away from bitter things which tend to be poisonous or bad for us, to, you know, have a disgust thing at rotten meat, you probably wouldn't survive very long. So we're motivated by self-interest in the state of nature. We eat things. We find comfortable places to sleep. You know, animals seem to threaten us. We either run away from them or we fight them, hopefully by banding together or by, you know, getting sticks and spears and primitive technology. Now, self-interest can lead us to do things that are harmful to each other. That's pretty clear. So if you and I disagree about the nature of something, and I think that it's in my self-interest, and you think that it's not really in my self-interest, and it would actually be harmful to you, but I'm just focusing only on my self-interest, I will probably harm you as a consequence. These sort of things happen all the time. Is there anything that could put a check upon that? So this is where, again, Rousseau is going to be criticizing Hobbes. He says, what is it that actually keeps us from being mean to each other, being harmful, being dangerous to each other? He says, well, if we think about the state of nature, the human being is in a state where they haven't developed the sort of passions, the sort of impulses that human beings in this state have. So if we're looking at human beings as we know them today, or as Hobbes knew them in the 17th century, around the time of the English Civil War, a time of horrible violence and bloodshed, great fear. Hobbes actually said, I was born together with fear, because he was born at the same time that the Armada is about to invade England. If we look at people like that, and then we sort of extrapolate from that to what it must be like for our primitive ancestors, then we're going to get, you know, some pretty brutish and mean ancestors. But these people haven't developed those kinds of feelings. And as Rousseau will say, neither the development of the understanding nor the restraint of law hinders them from doing ill. It's not that they've come up with ideas that keep them from doing ill, and it's not the restraint of law, because there isn't any law. The peacefulness of their passions and their ignorance of vice. It takes somebody coming along and saying, hey, maybe I should enslave you. That's a great idea for slavery to start to catch on. It's not something that is inherent to the human condition, according to Rousseau. Likewise, primitive human beings don't have the same array of desires and passions that we modern, civilized, in certain ways degenerate human beings possess and would bring into a natural environment. They're not sadistic, for example, the way that many human beings are. They don't delight in cruelty the way that many human beings do. There is one emotion that he does talk about which can provoke conflict between human beings, and that is the emotion of sexual desire, which is not yet the emotion of love, but that's something that is not, you know, ubiquitous, you know, happening all the time. That's something that comes upon people. Instead, we have another emotion which plays a much bigger role, and that's this natural compassion. So let's look at what he means by that. He says, there's another principle which has escaped Hobbes, which having bestowed upon mankind to moderate on certain occasions the impetuosity of egoism, or before its birth, the desire of self-preservation, tempers the ardor with which he pursues his own welfare. Why? By an innate repugnance at seeing a fellow creature suffer. So when we're talking about compassion, you can use the word sympathy, which was actually the more common term used at that time, or you can use the term compassion. These are both actually coming from the same roots, believe it or not. One is coming from Greek, one is coming from Latin. Sympathy is coming from sum, meaning together, and then pathe, meaning feeling, emotion. It means feeling the emotion that the other person is feeling, or feeling alongside with them, feeling, identifying with them in some way. Same thing with compassion. The com is Latin for with, does the same thing that sim does, and passio is the Latin translation of pathe. So it's really meaning the same thing. And the idea is that sympathy is a reaction to the what we can call the vulnerability of the other. Vulnerability to what? To suffering. To harm. Even to death. Rousseau talks about this as being something that is not unique to human beings, but which we can observe at least in the higher animals. And one of the evidences that he's trying to provide for this, I'm not really sure if animal behaviorists bear this out. They certainly do in the case of, say, elephants and some other higher animals, is that animals, when they see one of their own kind who is dead, they will feel a kind of grief or sadness or, you know, perhaps even dread in relation to it. We see this among animals who take care of each other when they get sick. You know, we have this tendency to think, well, you know, the sick, they just get rejected outside of the herd. But actually, there are cases where wounded or sick animals will be taken care of, at least among mammals. I don't know that spiders do this. I don't know that crustaceans do this. I don't know that yellow jackets do this. You know, they were at the level of arthropods. I don't know that reptiles even do this or that birds do it. But mammals certainly do. And Rousseau has in mind this sort of impulse, this innate desire to help out or to alleviate the hurt, the injury, the sadness, the danger. We could also put the threats, the vulnerability of the other. There's an innate repugnance at seeing a fellow creature suffer. He says, I don't fear contradiction in holding man to be possessed of the only natural virtue which could not be denied in him by the most violent attractor of human virtue. I'm speaking of compassion, which is a disposition suitable to creatures so weak and subject to so many evils as we certainly are. By so much the more universal and useful to mankind as it comes before any kind of reflection. What is he saying there? He's saying that this is not something that we actually have to think about. You know, you could in fact think about, should I help this person here? You know, when you're debating about what charity to give money to, or, you know, you're watching a television program and suddenly one of those Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals tearjerkers comes on and shows you the puppies that are being, you know, boarded up. I won't go into all that stuff. We actually have to turn those off because they make my wife so upset, and she's somebody who supports that sort of cause because she's feeling what Rousseau would call this sense of sympathy. She has a highly developed sense of sympathy. I know I felt something like this when I was a kid. I would get a birthday present every year, and right after my birthday, which is in, you know, late August, would come the Jerry Lewis telethon for muscular dystrophy, and I would see these people who were afflicted, and each year I'd get, you know, maybe $10 or $20, and I'd give it to that charity because I felt bad. I felt sad. Now, what's going on here is, Rousseau says, a kind of identification with the other. Instead of just being motivated by our own self-interest, by how it affects us, we care about what happens to other people. He thinks that this is innate. This is something that you can, you know, burn out of human beings by treating them in very cruel ways, by putting them in contexts and societies where it becomes, very detrimental to show compassion. You can, by habit, get people to stop feeling this sort of thing and to feel other things. But if you just leave human beings alone, they are going to feel this. And, you know, the worst people are the people who don't feel this, according to Rousseau, what we would call sociopaths. Great example. We often talk of sociopaths as lacking empathy, but what we really mean is that they lack what Rousseau is calling compassion. So he says, this is a pure emotion of nature prior to all kinds of reflection. Such is the force of natural compassion. The greatest depravity of morals has as yet hardly been able to destroy. And he gives some examples here that are really kind of interesting. He says, we daily find at our theaters men affected, no shedding tears at the sufferings of a wretch who, were he in the tyrant's place, would probably even add to the torments of his enemies. Like Sulla, who was a Roman leader in the times of the civil wars, who is so sensitive to the ills he had not caused. We can feel this sense of compassion towards people who don't even deserve it, and who, if we were going to help out, would turn out to be complete, blackguards and bastards, to use the sort of language that they used at that time. Tyrants, the kind of people who are cruel. You see one of them fall into a pit and break their leg. You can still feel a sense of compassion for them. So this is not something that is thought out. This is not something that, provides us with a whole code of morality. This is something that is at the level, you might say, of the human heart or of the gut. So he goes on and he says, what tends to mute this? Reasoning. The more you think, the less likely you are to feel compassion, or the less you'll feel compassion. He says, reason engenders self-respect. Reflection confirms it. But reason turns a human mind back upon itself and divides him from everything that could disturb or afflict him. So philosophy makes us less compassionate, he says. Now, he goes on and he says, compassion is a natural feeling and it moderates the love of self in each individual. It contributes to the preservation of the whole human species. Why is that? Well, think about it. If children need to be protected, children are vulnerable, children, if we don't feel compassion towards them, if we don't take care of them, there goes the entire human species. There will no longer be a human race. He says, compassion hurries us without reflection to the relief of those who are in distress. This is what, in a state of nature, supplies the place of all these other things, like law. We don't need law. We don't need morality if we actually have compassion, at least in the state of nature. So he says, this will prevent a sturdy savage from robbing a weak child or a feeble old man of the sustenance they may have with pain and difficulty acquired, if he sees a possibility of providing for himself by other means. So in primitive society, it's not a sense of honor or, a sense of moral codes. It's not, laws or stuff like that that keep people from being, as Hobbes called them, wolf to each other. Man is a wolf to wolf. A man is a wolf to man, Hobbes said. It's rather this sense of compassion. It's rather this sense of, well, the other person, they could suffer, and I don't want to cause them suffering. So he goes on, and he says, when we see this sort of thing, it takes a lot of different forms. We can talk about it in a sense of generosity. What is generosity? Compassion applied to the weak. Compassion applied to those who need our help. Clemency. What is clemency? Clemency is when somebody does a wrong thing to us and we don't take revenge on them. We show compassion to them instead. Humanity, that's just extended to everybody, to the whole human species. Friendship, benevolence, these are all forms of compassion, Hobbes says. Because, in friendship, some friendships are a matter of people having self-interest and, I scratch your back, you scratch mine, I'll help you with the homework and you make me nice meals. I used to have an arrangement like that, a tutoring arrangement when I was an undergraduate. But sometimes you help the other person out just because you sense that they actually need the help and you're not getting anything in return. That's compassion. That's what genuine friendship has to be based on for Rousseau. When we pity somebody, we are feeling compassion towards them. So all of these things are examples of the kind of natural morality that human beings in a state of nature are going to feel. Now, what gets us out of that? The progress of human development. And one key thing that's going to happen is we begin living together in more or less permanent associations. So when we do that, we are spending time with the same people, we come to share the same basic language, we share the same diet, we share the same mode of thinking about things, and we gradually become what we could call a people or a tribe or a clan, or Rousseau will even use the word nation. We begin to, you know, form families, and those families marry with other families within the same society. And now we have more complex banding together of human beings. Now we're actually moving to the second part of the discourse on inequality. So what happens then? Like you said, some of this is actually coming out of self-interest, taught by experience that the love of well-being is the sole motive of human actions, except for, of course, sympathy. He found himself in a position to distinguish the few cases in which mutual interest might justify him in relying upon the assistance of his fellows. Also, the still fewer cases in which a conflict of interest might give him cause to suspect them. In the former case, he joined to the same herd with them into some sort of association. And in the other case, he would avoid them. So we begin to start doing mutual undertakings on the basis of self-interest. We could also think of this in terms of compassion. We're also doing things based on associating with each other. So he talks about the human heart expanding in this novel situation. And what does this do? He says, As the human beings are provided with leisure, as they're in conjunction with each other all of this time, as they're staying in the same location, the same basic life situation with each other, what are they doing? He talks about the fact that we begin to engage in consideration. And another word that he uses is comparison. We begin to compare objects against each other. So we come up with, you know, notions by doing that, new ideas. Ideas like beauty. What is it for something to be beautiful, to be attractive? Something is beautiful in relation to something else. We talk about a song as being beautiful because it captivates us, but we contrast it to other songs that don't do that. We talk about human beings as being beautiful or handsome or good-looking or whatever we want to say, being hot, being, sexy, all these sorts of things. But we do that like on a scale. Is that person a 10 or are they a 1? Are they a 2? Are they a 5? You know, what happens when a 5 goes out with a 2? Or a 7 goes out with a 5? Notice what we're doing there. We're engaging in a very complex set of comparisons. And so attractiveness, beauty, that's one of those things. We also think in terms of moral conceptions, like merit. Oops, I almost put Mary. Merit. What a person deserves, the value that they have. Somebody deserves this, but they don't deserve that. I will go this far with you, but I will not go this far with you. And there's a lot of cases where, you know, somebody, you know, we might feel I'm going to help them out of compassion, where merit would say, no, don't help that person. Think about the example of the tyrant. You know, if I help that person, they're going to be the next Hitler. Do you actually help Hitler out of the pit? If you have natural compassion, and that's what's running the show, you do. If you realize that, no, this guy's going to do some terrible stuff, you leave him in the pit, right? So beauty and merit, we can talk about other sorts of ideas that are coming about as well. He says preference. When we talk about preference, we're saying that one thing is ranked higher than another. What are your preferences as far as dinner? This is an issue that a lot of couples get into, and a lot, even worse when you have a bunch of friends. Let's go out. Let's eat. That sounds great. I want to go out and eat. So now we have a desire, right? Where do you want to go? I don't know. Do you want to have pizza? No, I don't want to have pizza. Do you want to have tacos? I don't really want to have tacos. You want to have Chinese? Nah, I don't really have a taste for Chinese. All right, well, give me some idea of where you actually want to go. Do you want to go to the fancy French restaurant? Nah, I don't want to spend all that much money. Do you want to just go home and maybe order in? I don't know. And then you say, all right, rank order from top to bottom what your actual preferences are. And you can do this with a, you know, a couple, you can do this with a group, you know. All right, we're going to figure out tacos are first, and then pizza is second. That's an order of preference. Now, we can do this with all sorts of other stuff. Should you go to college? Should you just go to work? Should you go on the dole instead? That's asking you about your preferences. All of these sorts of things become very important once we get to semi-civilized or barbarian or savage society. The kinds of groups that, you know, Europeans were actually encountering and writing ethnographical accounts of, which often tended to be pretty, you know, pretty off base, but it's what the best that they had at the time. So Rousseau says, each began to consider the rest and to wish to be considered in turn. Thus a value came to be attached to what he's calling public esteem. Now, what does it mean to have public esteem? We often hear this word esteem in terms of self-esteem. There's like a whole movement. Students need to have self-esteem. We've got to make you feel good about yourselves. That'll be, you know, determinative in whether you're able to do well in the classroom. That was not the case when I was a kid, by the way. And that may not be the case for future generations once we see that there isn't an intrinsic connection between these things. Public esteem means your value that you have for other people in the society. Self-esteem is how you think about yourself. A lot of times that can be totally off base. As a matter of fact, they've done studies that have shown quite interestingly that, you know, if you divide things into quartiles as far as like attractiveness, intelligence, you know, successfulness, all these sorts of things, people in the top three quarter usually have fairly clear and accurate self-assessments. You know, so people who are really smart, they usually know that they're really smart. People who are not so smart usually know that they're not so smart. People in the bottom quartile will quite often think that they are actually much higher up than they are. So, you know, self-esteem can often be, you know, something very subjective. Public esteem, that can also be subjective as well. Think about the celebrity that we accord to people in our society, and, you know, the basis on which we actually made them celebrities. Some of them probably didn't deserve it. Some of them, there's probably a lot of great people who never got brought to anybody's attention who would be much more deserving, much more meritorious of having that spotlight on them. But public esteem is something that we do come to value. And so people think about, how do other people see me? And what people want to do in that case then is everybody wants to be, I'm going to use a sort of a diagram here, everybody wants to be at least on the same level as everybody else, right? Nobody wants to be below the norm. Wouldn't it be nice if we could all be above average? No, it wouldn't, because that can't happen, right? Average is the middle part. And then there's always going to be some people who are trying to, you know, place themselves above the rest as well because they think that they deserve it more. And so what we get into here is the development of codes of morality that say how you have to behave towards people, how you have to treat people, so that not only are you not hurting them, but you're not showing contempt towards them. You're not saying, I am better than you are. You are lower than I am. And so if you think about what we often talk about as manners in our own society is supposed to do, it's something like this. If you see somebody coming and, you know, you're like, they're like two steps away from the door and you just went in, do you hold the door open for them or not? Good manners says that you should hold the door open for them. There, you know, in the past, there used to be things like, well, women don't have to do it, but men should always do it. Now it's pretty much equal opportunity. If somebody is there at the door and you, let's say they have a bunch of, you know, packages in their hand, and, you know, you're in a bit of a hurry, but you can stop for 2 seconds and hold the door open. Do you do it? What if you, instead of opening the, or holding the door open for them, you slam it shut and say, aha, screw you, now you've really shown that person that you think you're better than they are, that they deserve to be treated contemptuously. You've violated a code of manners, and there's all sorts of codes of manners that are also codes of morality. You know, a lot of the discussions that we get into, a lot of the disputes that we get into, involve this sort of conception of morality. Now, in primitive societies, what goes along with this is punishments. And the punishments tend to be pretty severe. If you actually look at primitive societies where, you know, they don't have laws in place, but they have customs and traditions instead, and there's no centralized authority that decides all these sorts of things, but instead people mete out justice according to what they see fit, then punishments tend to be pretty severe. And why are they so severe? Well, Rousseau tells us why this is the case. He says, revenge became terrible, men became bloody and cruel. Everyone before the institution of law was the only judge and offender of the injuries done him, so that the goodness which was suitable in the pure state of nature was no longer proper in the newborn state of society. Punishments had to be more severe as opportunities for offending became more frequent. As society is becoming more complex, we are actually becoming more vulnerable to each other. And so these codes of morality allow us to have a condition in which hopefully we're not going to be hurt or shown contempt by other people, but if they do show us contempt and we have enough force, we can punish them severely and make them, you know, say, I did the wrong thing and try to make it up to us, and discourage other people from being jerks to us, from doing similar sorts of things. So he says, the dread of vengeance had to take the place of the rigor of law. Men became less patient and their natural compassion had suffered. But this is not a bad condition according to Rousseau. So here we have a new addition to what's going on here. It's not as if this disappears altogether. This gets continued into this state here. And now we're going to have a transition to another new state. What we're talking about here, before we get to the institution of law, is the development of complex civilizations, of societies that have gone beyond just the tribal level, that have gone through the agricultural and metallurgical revolution, and in which people are becoming more numerous, they're in certain ways becoming more prosperous, but new inequalities are also starting to emerge. And a lot of those inequalities are going to come about because of wealth. And wealth is originally taking shape in terms of property, in terms of the land that an agricultural worker works, or the forge that a smith has, or the tools that the smith has actually made by his own labor, or the grain which has been produced on the land, or potatoes, or cucumbers, or whatever you have. You know, cucumbers, by the way, one of the earliest cultivated plants. We see that in the Sumerian, these Sumerian myths that cucumbers were talked about even then. So, what we have going on now is that property is being recognized. Property is leading to trade. And when we think about trade, what we've got is some sort of exchange taking place. So, exchanges should be of equal value, but they're not going to be of equal value, and what's going to end up happening over time is that we're going to see a differentiation of some people becoming rich and some people becoming poor. And there can be a middle class in between, but what really matters is this dynamic of rich and poor. So the interchange between rich and poor is going to favor, over time, the rich. The rich are going to become richer. The poor are going to become poorer. At the same time, what's going on in this complex society is all of these people are vulnerable to each other. They all have greater needs. And they all want to secure their own needs. They want to satisfy them. This is a matter of self-interest. They may, in fact, still, if they feel any natural compassion, care about the needs of other people. They may still be motivated by notions of honor or, you know, this is the way it ought to be or tradition or stuff like that. But for the most part, people are focused on themselves. And the rich, of course, have a great advantage. They can hire the poor to attend to their needs. They can get what they need from other rich people, from the middle class. The poor are screwed, though. The poor cannot satisfy their needs. And so what do they end up having to do? Some of them are going to become servants. I'm actually not going to put them on top. Put them on the bottom. Servants, or another word for this, slaves. And you can see this happening in a lot of societies. As a matter of fact, ancient Athens was a great example. The Athenian democracy came about in the first place because previous to that, the rich had actually enslaved the poor through debt. If you got into debt, you could be sold and your children and your wife could be sold or your husband could be sold to pay the debt. And so this entire slave class ends up being generated as a result. Now, some people don't want to be slaves. So what do? They still have to provide for their needs, and they can't provide for their needs themselves. They don't own land. They don't have property. Where else are they going to get it? Well, they turn to crime. Or, you know, as Rousseau puts it, brigandage, which means becoming a bandit, going out and breaking into rich people's estates and taking their stuff. Now, the rich are going to propose something new here. And Rousseau calls this the most ingenious idea that human beings have come up to this point. And what the rich do is they look at this situation that they're in, and they say to themselves, okay, we actually own most of the stuff, and we're doing pretty good overall, but how are we going to make our own position more secure? How can we keep from actually suffering at the hands of the poor? Because as Rousseau says, the most powerful or the most miserable consider their might or their misery as a kind of right to the possessions of others, equivalent in their opinion to that of property. So the poor, if they're servants, okay, that's fine for the rich. Terrible for the servants, of course, because they lack freedom, they're treated miserably, they have no way to get out of their situation. But the ones who are poor and are criminals pose a danger to the rich, and the rich would like to get rid of that. So what do they do? He says, they came up with the profoundest plan that ever entered into the mind of man. This was to employ in his favor the forces of those who attacked him. The forces of those who attacked him are the poor. To make allies of his adversaries, again the poor, to inspire them with different maxims, that means to give them a new set of ideas, and to give them other institutions as favorable to himself as the law of nature was unfavorable. So what does he do? He says, let us join to guard the weak from oppression, to restrain the ambitious, and to secure to every man the possession of what belongs to him. Let's make sure that everybody's property is respected. Let us institute rules of justice and peace to which all, without exception, may be obliged to conform. Rules that may in some measure make amends for the caprices of fortune by subjecting equally the powerful and the weak to the observance of reciprocal obligations. Let us, instead of turning our forces against ourselves in a civil war, collect them into a supreme power which may govern us by wise laws, protect and defend all the members of the association, and maintain eternal harmony among us. So what we've got here is the institution of a legal regime. Now, this is something new. One of the key elements of this is that in the past, all of this morality that we're looking at, it may have been, you know, at a certain point grounded in and consolidated in tradition, but this is impersonal. This is general. It runs throughout all of society. All of this is based, in to some degree, in what is personal. You know, one's self-interest is one's self-interest. Natural compassion is something that somebody feels towards another. Morality that involves comparison of, you know, are you treating me the way I don't want to be treated? Am I treating you the way that you don't want to be treated? It involves personal relations. This is impersonal. This is general. And it purports to provide a kind of equality. We talk about this as equality before the law. Everybody is treated the same way according to the legal regime. The question that we're going to ask ourselves then, now that we have this new conception of what's right and wrong in terms of the law, is it really going to be equal or not?